gentlemen, it is my pleasure to welcome everyone on this virtual platform. We would like to extend a special welcome for our speaker, Mr. Soham, who will be speaking on Indian Succession Act. We are so excited to have you all here to participate in this very special meeting organized by Madras Presidency Lawyers Forum. We could not have pulled off this meeting without hard work and dedication of Mr. Ravi Meenakshi Sundaram, Mr. Manikandan, last but not least, Mr. Ram Mayappan, and our MPLF forum, who have worked tirelessly for all our meets. I hope that today's meet inspires ideas and discussions that can bring about constructive and transforming changes in all our fields. Thank you everyone. Over to Manikandan sir for ground rules.
Thank you, Jayanti. Over to Manikandan.
Yeah, good evening one and all. The once the session commences, the mic for the speaker alone will be on and others will be on mute, and the session will go for 45 minutes by the speaker. Once the session is completed by the speaker, and we will be giving an option of one question per person, and once the question is raised by the person, they can mute themselves, and after that the session will go for an end for the day. May I now request Ravi Meenakshi Sundaram sir to give the introduction speech.
Thank you, Manikandan, and thank you, Madras Presidency Lawyers Forum. And this particular introduction, I request Soham to ask his partner or his friends or our advocates from Pune, either Anita or Vaishali. But I don't know why he was so adamant and he forced me that he requested me to do the introduction. He has sent me many pages, but I have cut short to because we wanted to hear more from him. I've just made some cut shots and hear about Soham. And before starting about Soham, and if you see, there is a saying, when you breathe in and breathe out, you can have the Soham. When you breathe in, it will be so, and if you breathe out, it will be hum, it will be ending like. So maybe his parents have thought that he should be in their breath all the time. So they made him this name. He's a graduate from DES Law College, Pune. And he's a third generation lawyer, where his grandfather, late Govind Bhaskar Panse, was a leading lawyer at Pune, and followed by his father, Anand Panse. They both have more than 40-50 years bar experience from their family. Now Soham has come. And he is a person, even any case, he never says no. Whatever comes in, he takes up. But he wanted to specialize in this Succession Act and inheritance law, then matrimonial and will and other matters. He is more concentrating, and he wanted to do tax also at one time because they have got divisions in their office. They have got associates where they have got three people as a partner, Siddharth as a partner, and they are all under their father. And his parents, mother, and I think she is fond of Soham. And she wanted Soham to become either Harish Salve or Nani Palkiwala level. And we all hope and bless him that let him what our mother's choice be. I introduce our Soham Anand Panse to the participants here. Thank you all, and thank you Madras Presidency for giving this opportunity. Now over to Soham for his lecture for 45 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi sir, for such a great introduction, and it is indeed an honor to be presenting this topic before such an esteemed gathering. As you know, that Indian Succession Act is a very vast topic, and to summarize it, or to even get close to just completing it in 45 minutes is going to be a task. So first of all, I've actually tried myself and restricted myself to only the provisions which are relating to the testamentary succession and which are more in detail. So I'll be focusing mainly in relation to the testamentary successions which have been contained in the Indian Succession Act 1925. So moving ahead, so just let me start by stating what are the objects and the reasons why the Indian Succession Act 1925 was enacted. Firstly, the act came into existence on 30th of September 1925, and the only sole purpose why it came into existence was to consolidate all the Indian laws relating to succession and inheritance. So as we know that India is a diverse country, and there are various religions and various religions. So only with the motto to consolidate the Indian laws and to have a streamlined approach towards the succession aspect of considering it to be an Indian concept, the Indian Succession Act was enacted in the year 1925. Now moving forward, when we say about the Indian Succession Act, we have to consider more about the important definitions which have to be related to. So for the important definitions, it is Section 2A, that is the definition of the administrator, which has to be relied upon. And the definition of the administrator is that the administrator is a person who is there, so I would just like to go through the definition of administrator as mentioned in the act itself. So it means a person appointed by the competent authority to administer the estate of the deceased. So wherever there is no executor who has been appointed, it is always the administrator who has to set the will in motion, and that is why it is required that the administrator is appointed, and it has been defined under Section 2A of the provisions of Indian Succession Act. Section 2B deals with the codicil aspect, and a codicil is nothing but an annexure to a will which is being prepared after the original will has been prepared, or after the main will has been prepared, not say the original will, but the main will which has been prepared. Now coming to the Section 2C, which is immediately after that, that is the executor. So who is an executor? So executor is a person who has been authorized by the will to act after the testator as per his will which is being made and what are his wishes which is given in the will. So an executor is appointed to execute those directions as per the will. So that is an executor. The other important aspect is Section 2F. That is 2F deals with the probate. So what is the probate? Probate, again, I would like to just spend a minute or two on the definition, because probate is a very important definition, and the majority of the litigations or the things which come out of the Indian Succession Act are mainly in relation to the probate, because probate is the most contested issue when it comes out. So probate, what is probate? Probate means a copy of the will certified under the seal of the court of the competent jurisdiction with the grant of administration to the estate of the deceased. So again, I would like to just bifurcate here what the definition means. So definition is, it is a copy of the will which is certified. So it shows that it is the will is certified by the court, and there only after that the probate is granted. So that is why the probate definition also becomes very important in the aspect of relating to the provisions of Indian Succession Act. And more importantly, the definition of will, which has been mentioned in Section 2H, and which is the most important aspect when we deal with the testamentary succession provisions, because when we say testamentary succession, it is either the probate or the letters of administration which come only in existence when there is a will which is in existence. So again, just reading and quoting the definition of Section 2H, which has been given in the Indian Succession Act. So it means a legal declaration of the intention of the testator with respect to his property, which desires to be carried into the effect after his death. So, as it is evidently clear from the definition of will has been divided into five major aspects and the five key aspects. The first aspect is that it is a legal declaration. So it is a legal, it has a legal validity, legal sanctity, and it is a legal declaration. Second, it is an intention of the testator or the person who is making the will. So that is the second most important aspect, that when a will is made, it is the intention of the person who is making the will, which is very important. Then the third important aspect, that what is it relating to? It is relating to the important aspect that it is relating to the property of the person who is making the will. And we will, going through the provisions of testamentary succession, it is very evident that we'll come to know how this property is very much essential, because there are certain sections in this act itself which go on further, that where a will is not possible or where the will not take an effect. So when it is his property, it is more important, and that is another important aspect. The fourth and the key aspect is the desire aspect of it, which is why the will is called as a will, and therefore a will is supposed to be what is his desire. And the last but not the least important aspect which is there, that is the will is after his death or after the testator's death. That means the will only come into an existence after the death of the person and not before that. So there again, as I told you, that this is again how we'll revisit in the chapter 6, which deals with the testamentary succession provisions and how these things are interrelated to each other, and how the definition of the will, which has been mentioned in section 2H, has its relevance in the coming sections, in the part 6, which deals specifically with the testamentary successions. Now, going more further, then coming to the main topic for today's discussion, which we have, that is the testamentary succession. So, the testamentary succession, in short, is been dealt in the part 6 of the Indian Succession Act. And as per the alignment of the sections, or the alignment of how the sections are to be interpreted, they have been divided into 23 various chapters, of which we'll be glancing through each one of them. It is not possible to just go into the depth of each and every section due to the paucity of time, and more importantly, the legal implications which are involved. So it is normally, each chapter can be a separate kind of discussion or a separate issue which we can discuss at length. And more importantly, further, it has been divided into 57. It is from section 57 to section 191 of the Act. And there are also some allied sections which I would be definitely covering in the later part of my presentation, which are again related to the testamentary succession, even though they have not been governed under the part 6 of the Act. So, part 6, an overview. So this is what how the part 6 has been dealt with, and how the part 6 has been conducted or has been drafted by the makers of this Act, and how this is going to go further. I have actually tried to simplify it while making the presentation. These are not the exact headings which are available, which are not there as per the text of the BARE Act. But yes, it is as per the understanding, and it will be beneficial, or it will be easy to understand it. So what is the chapter 1? The chapter 1 is an introductory section, and it is it has two sections involved. That is section 57 and 58 of the Act. And 57 says it is application of this provision to certain parts of the will, which are made by Hindus, etc. So it is actually about to whom does this part apply, and to which wills does this part apply. So that is the most important thing which has been mentioned in this section. And going even further, where does the provisions of will apply, and where does the provisions of the probate or the letters of administration apply, and where they do not apply in other sense. So that is what has been briefly mentioned in section 57 of the Act. And going further in section 58, it says general application of the part. So if section 57 is a specific provision relating to application of this part, section 58 is a general application to this part, wherein it says that how this part is going to be applicable to the other portions or other religions. But this Act specifically says, and I would like to pause here and take you through that section 58 subsection 1, it says the provisions of this part shall not apply to the testamentary succession to a property of any Mohammedan nor any as provided by section 57. So section 58 gives us two most important aspects, that Indian Succession Act specifically does not apply to the Mohammedans, and the section 58, which is general application of this part, will not apply to provisions of to all already what has been stated in the section 57. So all whatever has been left open or maybe not considered by section 57, it has been considered by section 58. Now coming to the other most important aspect, that is the chapter 2, which deals with the wills and codicils. So chapter 2 starts with section 59 and goes up to section 62, where the main aim or the main objective of section 50 from section 59 to 62 is about the persons who are capable of making the wills, which section 52 talks about. Then what are the various things for which the will can be drafted? That is coming to an interesting aspect, that is section 60. And section 60 deals with the testamentary guardian. So testamentary guardian is a procedure or enactment of this act itself, which says that any guardian for a property of the minor or for the minor's well-being can also be appointed by his father by drafting a will as per the section 60 of the Indian Succession Act 1925. Then the section 61 also deals about on what grounds the will can be challenged and on what grounds the will can be declared as void or illegal, null and illegal as well as null. So it talks about the will which has been obtained by fraud, coercion or importunity. So and moving further, section 62, as we all are aware of, that will may be altered or revoked. So what are the provisions relating to the alteration and revocation? Even though they have been discussed in detail in the chapter 5, the basic shift or the basic mention of them has been mentioned in the chapter 2 of this act, and more particularly section 62, which deals with the wills may be revoked or altered. Now coming to the chapter 3 of this act, which is about the execution of unprivileged wills. Now we'll have to pause here and we'll have to find out the difference, because as it is evidently clear and it is seen that there is an execution of unprivileged wills and there is also something known as privileged wills. So what is the difference between an unprivileged will and a privileged will, and what are the different modes of execution of an unprivileged will and a privileged will? So let us now just shift our attention at this point of time for unprivileged wills. So the unprivileged wills are the wills which have been prepared by any person and who is an Indian citizen, and what are the modes of execution for which the will can be executed, and they have been given in section 63 and section 64 of this act. So it tells us that what is necessary for execution of an unprivileged will. It says that there has to be the testator or the person who is making will has to sign in front of the attesting witnesses, and the attesting witnesses have to sign in front of the testator also. Now going even further, it is also the section 63 sub clause C. It says that whether more than two witnesses either it is not compulsory that both the witnesses need to sign in front of the testator at the same point of time. The testator can sign in front of either one of them, but the other person, or if the let's put it in an example that A makes a will and B and C are that witnesses for that will. So when A makes a will and B is only present when the A signs that will, so B will sign the will in front of A, and then after that maybe B leaves the premises and then the C comes, then C can also sign the will, but that will has to be in presence of the testator and not otherwise. Otherwise, that witness does not become valid. So it is a way by which the execution of the will can take place, and the execution of the will can happen by signing. It can be also affixing a thumb impression or any other mark which the testator can also put, or the witnesses also can put. So that way it can definitely happen. And going even further, section 64, I would like to pause here for a moment, because normally in this is a section which even I came across when I was preparing for the presentation, that we normally feel that whatever has been relied upon or whatever has been written in the will is the only part and parcel of the will, or whatever is the annexure which we do or the codicil which we form is the annexure of the will. But section 64 talks about this, that incorporation of papers by reference. So what does this mean? It is a very unique concept. It says that when in a will there is a person who has mentioned about some document, or he has mentioned expressly in the will that this is a document which he wants to rely upon. So as per the section 64 of the act, whatever he says that he relies upon that document, that document also forms the part and parcel of the will. And it therefore, as I said, that this concept even is something which we need to also understand, that okay, fine, if there is some letter, if there is some document which has been referred by the testator in his will, and he has mentioned it in such a brief description that it can be relied upon. And going even further, when we come about in the chapter 6, which deals with the construction of the will, we'll definitely come to know that how the will can be constructed. So this is the foundation stone of it, that any document which has been relied upon by the testator, it can be considered. Now going further, in the case of privileged wills, so as I was mentioning earlier, that why there are two classes of will which have been mentioned. So unprivileged will, as we have already seen above, that what does it encompass and what does it take into consideration. Section 6, chapter 4, and specifically section 65 deals the privileged wills, privileged wills. So I would like to just make a small mention, or rather read the definition of the privileged will, which has been enshrined in the Indian Succession Act. The privileged wills: any soldier being employed in an expedition or an engagement in the actual warfare, or an airman so employed or engaged, or any mariner being at sea, if he has completed the age of 18 years, may dispose of his property by a will made in the manner provided in section 66. Such wills are called privileged wills. So section 65 deals categorically, or defines what a privileged will is. So it is a will which has been made by a person who is in defense, and more particularly any person who is a mariner and is at sea. So this is something which we need to consider, which is very much important. And going further in section 66, it talks about what are the modes of making and the execution of the privileged wills. And these, I will not go into the depth of section 66 much in detail, because it a major time will be consumed explaining each and every provision there too. But I would like to just make sure that even if we go by or glance by the provisions, they are self-explanatory in nature, to this effect, that how a privileged will can come into existence and what are the modes of execution of the privileged wills. And there is no ambiguity per se to discuss about it, or to just not to discuss about it, but to just go into the depth of it and to discuss how the privilege will be executed in detail. Now, coming to more important aspect, that is the chapter 5, which deals with the attestation, revocation, alteration, and revival. So, interestingly, that again, as I was preparing for this seminar, I would like to just say that once you see the section 57 of this act, the section 57 of this act, there is a proviso after the subclause C which is there. And it says, provided that marriage shall not revoke any will or codicil. But when you come to the chapter 5 of this chapter 5 of this part 6, it says in section 69 that revocation of will by testator's marriage. So here again, there are various scenarios which have been mentioned in detail from section 67 to section 73, which deals with the provisions of attestation, revocation, alteration, and revival. So it is now we'll focus mainly on section 73. That is, if a if we have to revive a will, how do we revive it? So here again, if there consider for example, there is Mr. A who has prepared a will, and once he has prepared a will, he says that he wants to revoke it, but he revokes it only in part, and the later part later of the aspect of the will still remains to be revoked. And later on, by his own acts, and he revokes the remainder of the will also. And when he says he wants to revive that will, he can do so by a way of codicil or by a way of making another will by which the will is revived. But it is pertinent here to note that the will be revived only to the extent that it was not it was revoked for the initial instance, and it would not be for the entire will which has been revoked, unless there is a thing which has been mentioned specifically in the codicil that both the parts, that is first revocation as well as the second revocation, is thought to be revived by this codicil. Now, I would like to spend much more of my time here on the construction aspect of it, because this is where the litigations which we see arise in the court of law. And this is also very much beneficial when we come to the construction of the will, or how a will which comes before the court needs to be interpreted by the court or by the advocates who file either for the letters of administration or for the probate. So coming to this, it is being mainly mentioned from section 74 to it has been till it has been till it is one second. It is from section 74 to section, it is a very big section, just hold on. Yeah, it is still section 1010. So it is section 112. So 74, I'll repeat once again. Section 74 to section 1111 is the chapter or which deals with the construction of the will. Now I would like to just move quickly to the construction aspects of it, wherein it is the section 74 categorically deals with the wording of the will. And why the wording of the will is important? Because the will, as we have already seen, it depends upon the person who has made the will, and it is his intention which is there, or his desire. So the wordings which he uses in the will are very much critical in that aspect, and therefore the construction aspect of it starts right from how the will has been worded, or how the intention of the testator has to be derived from wording of the will. Now going further, another important section in this chapter is section 77. It deals when the words may be supplied. So sometimes it happens that the will may not be prepared by an advocate. It can be prepared by a normal person. And he says that at some point of time, it is only the thing that is It is there is an example in this like thing I would like to quote. So it says that give 500 to my daughter. Give 500 to my daughter. Now 500 to my daughter, it won't make any sense. But here, as per the section 77, the words will have to be supplied, and those words will be 500 rupees. That is what it will have to be supplied to under any circumstances. So that is why we say that section 77 deals specifically with when the words may be supplied. Then going even further, the section 82, which is again an important clause or the important section which we have to deal with, that is meaning of the clause to be collected from the entire will. So I would like to make a statement here, or I would like to just relate the will with any other form of the document which we make. So when we make any document, as it is been settled position of law that any document has to be construed as an whole. So similarly, any will which has been made has to be construed as an whole. And therefore, the meaning of the clause has to be construed from reading the entire will and not in isolation. Then there are another aspects of it, and I would like to move to two aspects of it more particularly. One, which is relating to section 84, and then I would section 84, section 86, and section 88 of the Act. So what does section 88 of the 84 of the Act says? When two possible constructions are preferred. So in this case, when two possible constructions are preferred, the law itself says that the construction which is very much possible and which can be given some effect, that construction needs to be considered and not otherwise, or not any other thing which cannot be given an effect. That is what section 84 says. Now given moving further, that is section 86. So section 86 talks about the interpretation of the words repeated in different parts of the will. Now, once we deal with section 86 of the Act, it is evidently clear that even though a word which will come in a will on a very different things, or it may be different paragraphs or on a different pages, but still, as per the section 86 of the Act, it has to be interpreted in the same sense as it arises in the will, or it was written in the will at the very first instance. So it is very much necessary in that regard. And coming to section 88, so what does it say? The last of the two inconsistent clauses prevail. So here I would like to again pause for a moment and just it is a very interesting section to go ahead with. So when there are two inconsistent clauses in the will, and when they stand together, it is always that the last clause which has been mentioned in the will which will prevail. So if you there is an illustration in this regard. So when A says that there is a property which he leaves, it is his estate at Jamnagar, to A, and he says by his last will he leaves it to B and not to A. So X makes a will and says that he wants to leave his estate which is situated at Ramnagar to A, but later on he says that he wants to give the same estate to B. Now these are two inconsistent clauses, but in this regard, the clause which was there in regard to bequeathing of that property to B will prevail and not to the A, even though it has been mentioned earlier. So it is very clear that whenever it is, and this, the last clause which is inconsistent will prevail. Now going even further, I would like to also stop here and make a mention of section 100, which has been also mentioned in the chapter 6 and deals with the construction. So here, as I thought that I should harp upon this section, because why? Because it says deals with the relationship of the testator with his children or with the people whom he has dealt with. So I would like to just read the headnote of section 100. It says, words expressly expressing relationship denotes only legitimate relatives, or failing such relatives, reputed legitimate. So whenever there is a mention of a relationship that I want to bequeath my property to son or to my daughter or to my nephew, grandson or anything, it is always very much clear as per the section 100 of the act that it is always legitimate. And if at all there is some other interpretation which has to be made possible, it has to be made expressly by the testator, and otherwise it is not possible. Now, going even further, the other aspects of it, if we go in detail, as I already mentioned in the start of the presentation, that if we go, each chapter can be a separate point for discussion, and even going further and respecting that, I have only 45 minutes at my disposal. I'll go on to the next aspect of it, which is the chapter 7, which deals with void bequest. And it is a very, the alignment of this section is such that void, in as per the contract provisions of Contract Act, we all know that void means one which cannot be enforced in the eyes of law. Similarly, those bequests which cannot be enforced in the eyes of law are known as void bequest, and therefore any bequest or any property which has been given by the testator through which comes under this cannot take an effect and should not be also considered by either the executor or by the administrator at the time of making the said things. So going even further, chapter 8, which is about vesting or legacies. So it talks about how the legacy or how it can be done is about it. And it says that when a legacy will be due to a person. So that is more important when we go ahead with it. Then from section 119 of the act to section 121 of this said act. And going just a bit behind, that is section chapter 8 relating to the void bequest. So it starts with section 112 of the Indian Succession Act, and it goes to section 118 of the act. Now going further, what is onerous bequest? Onerous bequest, I would like to just pause here for what is the meaning of the onerous bequest. And once that meaning is clear, it is evidently clear what the sections and the preceding sections in this chapter would mean. And that is, onerous bequest is that which comes up with an obligation, and any person who wants to accept that bequest has to follow the obligation first. So that is what is more important when it is an onerous bequest. Then, and the onerous bequest has been explained in detail in section 122-123 of the act. Now coming to the chapter 10, that is the contingent bequest aspect of it. The contingent bequest, as we have again come across this term in the provisions of Indian Contract Act 1872, the contingent bequest is one which is dependent upon happening of some event which is uncertain. So once that event only happens, this bequest will take its effect, but this event, as it is uncertain, may or may not happen. So this bequest may or may not take the effect, and if the happening of that event is not in the hands of the testator. So this is in short what it relates to in the case of a contingent bequest, and it has been enshrined from section 124 and 125 of the act. Now coming even further is related to the conditional bequest aspect. Now conditional bequest are those kind of bequests which impose the conditions on the legatees or the people who are going to acquire by way of will to fulfill certain conditions. And therefore, if the conditions are fulfilled, then only this bequest can be taken effect, or otherwise these bequests cannot be taken in effect. And they have been relied more importantly in section 126, 127, 128, 129, 130, 131, 132, 133, 134, 135, 136, and 137 of the Act. Now, as it is relating to the conditions, various conditions have been enshrined in this chapter, one below the other in the section format, and those conditions have to be enshrined and followed by the legatees. Otherwise, those bequests cannot be taken into effect, or those conditions cannot be laid down even by the testator while drafting a will. Now, if we come to the chapter 12, which deal with the bequest of directions, it says it is about the directions which have been given by the testator. So, the subtle difference between the conditional bequest and the bequest with directions. So, the conditional bequest deal with the conditions which are being imposed, and the conditions can be followed or may not be followed by the persons who are taking out of the will. But when it comes to the bequest with directions, it is necessary that those directions can be followed, because if those directions are not followed, the bequest will not take any effect, and the testator will be at the liberty to otherwise to ensure that the properties are bequeathed to any other person who is willing to follow those directions. And going again back to our previous discussion, that the will may be revoked or altered, and that can be done, and therefore the testator changes the directions as and now it becomes possible. Now, going even further, chapter 13 deals with only one section, but that one section is very important, and that one section is bequest to the executor. And here I would like it is again when we come to know that whether an executor can be a beneficiary out of the will. The section 141 gives an answer to it. Certainly, executor can be a beneficiary out of the will, but the only aspect which it deals with is that he should be ready to act as an executor out of the be the executor to execute that will and to act according to the wills and wishes of the testator. Otherwise, the said bequest will not take any existence. Going to section chapter 14, which deal with specific legacies. So, as the heading of this chapter is also very clear, it deals with specific legacies or specific kind of things which a testator wishes to bequeath to his heirs or his legatees. So, for example, if A has multiple jewelry and he says that he has a ring which he wants to bequeath to his son, so this becomes a specific legacy per se. If everyone is okay, I would be requiring another 10 to 15 minutes to complete, and then we can take the questions. Ravi sir, is that okay?
10 minutes fine?
Yeah, 10 minutes fine, sir. Not a problem. 10 minutes fine.
No problem.
Yeah. So, chapter 5. I'll just rush through this because I need to just harp on more on the other allied things of this. So it is demonstrative legacies, which is been described in chapter 15. So demonstrative legacies are again which demonstrate something, and those can take effect, and those have been mentioned in detail in chapter 15, and those are actually from section 150 and 151 of this act. Then coming to the adumption of legacies, this is another interesting concept, that how a legacy cannot take an effect, and the adumption basically means that a legacy which will not take an effect due to happening of certain circumstances which are either beyond the control of the testator or beyond the control of the legatee, and therefore this legacies will not take an effect. And going even further, then chapter 17, which deals with the payment of liabilities, that who will be paying the liabilities in respect of any legacy which has been given to the legatee. And if there are liabilities which are attached, whether he would be taking that, if he chooses to take it, it will be with the liability which will be involved. Then coming even further, chapter 18, which deals with the bequest of things which have been described generally. So anything which has been described generally can also be bequeathed, provided that the executor was appointed in the will can come across it. Then chapter 19, which is bequest of an interest or produce of funds. So when it is about the interest, it talks mainly about the life interest aspect of it, or when a fund which is created to sustain a legacy, it talks about that. So those provisions have been mentioned in chapter 19. Then coming to the bequest of annuities, it is again similar to the bequest which has been done by the fund, but the annuities which have been prepared, annuities forms a separate thing which is altogether, so it deals with that aspect of it. Then chapter 21, it deals with legacy to creditors or portioners. So it here I would like to just make a mention that when amount of debt which is a due to a creditor, and the testator gives him something out of the will, and there is no effect which is being made, that whether he is giving it out of his debt or he is just giving a legacy, then there is an interesting proposition that the creditor not only is due for the legacy which is being due to him by the will, but is also due to the debt which that the testator owed to him. And the important aspect which is with the aspect of election, and I would like to just make a brief mention of the doctrine of election here, and that is that when this is a normal ground of challenge when it comes to the wills which have been challenged, that the person says that the testator who made the will did not have the ownership of that property. So here the doctrine of election comes in a very handy, and when a person who is challenging the will or saying that the testator did not have the ownership of the property, it is up to him ki either he should deny the will in totality and say that the testator did not have any right with the property, or if he says that he wants to accept the property which the testator has been given him through virtue of will, he chooses the will, and then he cannot challenge the will per se. So this is the main crux which has been enshrined in the doctrine of election, and the gifts in contemplation of death. So this is the last chapter contained in part 6, which deals with the testamentary succession, that any gifts which have been contemplated in the gifts which have been given in the contemplation of deaths can also be mentioned in testamentary succession and can have an effect accordingly. Now, coming to this aspect, which I would like to just focus on, that these are the allied sections which, even though have not been mentioned specifically in part 6 of the Act, but they have an hand-in-glove effect with the said chapter. So, most importantly, it is section 213, which has been defined in part 8, and it says the right of the executor oblique legatee. So it is very important that a right of the executor or legatee has to be established who has been mentioned in the will, and he can do the same only by adhering to the provisions which have been mentioned in section 230. Now, going more importantly, in section 218 to 236A, that talks about grant of probate and letters of administration, and have been dealt with in detail in chapter 1 of part 9, and the various ways by which the executor or the executor can obtain the probate, or the letters of administration can be obtained where the executor is not willing to work, and the another things of aspects which come before us are always there which we can deal with. Now, coming to the another aspect of it, that is section 263, which has been again enshrined in the same part, but comes under the chapter 3, which deals with the revocation of grants. So the grants which have been earlier made under section 218 to 236A can be revoked under the provisions of section 263, and if it is for the just cause and if the court deems it fit, and which is always the matter of litigation when it comes to interpretation of the provisions under section of the provisions of Indian Succession Act. And very quickly, the section 276, which is the provision which deals with the application for probate, and how application for the probate should be made, and what are the necessities for the application of probate, and more importantly, if the executor has not been made in the will, as per the definition of section 2A of the Indian Succession Act, if the administrator has been appointed, he can make an application under section 278 for the application for letters of administration, and it has been mentioned in chapter 4 of part 9. So this was my presentation. So I guess I have taken exact 10 minutes as per the thing, and I would now leave it up to Ravi sir for the question and answer session, question and answers if any.
Over to Manigan. Let us first go for impressions before questions. I have three persons here. One is Mr. Ganesh Kumar. Then I got Siddha, and then Shivakumar. First, let me go with Ganesh because he's a versatile man. I request Ganesh Kumar to give his impression.
Hello, sir.
Hello, yes. Yes, Ganesh.
Sir, it was a fine lecture which we had for some time. In fact, you had made it possible in a very short time. You had almost covered all parts of the testamentary succession. It was so nice. And I hope that the young lawyers who are now hearing to this, without stopping this, they should also immediately take the act, go through all the provisions in the light of what the lecture you have now given. I hope that this will necessarily facilitate the young lawyers to their depth of knowledge in the subject, because it is, as you rightly said, it is very fast. It requires a lot of time, a lot of concentration to understand. But I'm sure that you had at least canvassed to all the provisions in a very short given point of time. And I hope that this will necessarily facilitate the young lawyers to develop in the present field. And I should also raise my appreciation for all the organizers. Mr. Ravi Meenakshi Sundaram, who has taken a lot of pain in performing this, taking this lecture to various other lawyers. And if at all any persons are benefited to this, the credit goes to the organizers. Thank you, sir.
Yes, it definitely does. Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the feedback. Yeah.
Thank you, Ganesh Kumar, for giving your impression. And one more thing, your knowledge. And in this Madras Lawyers Forum, only young lawyers, first timers, are given chances. And we are not going as of now to any public fame or such kind of a person. We wanted to encourage our co-brethren to come up. In that way, we have encouraged. And this is the 10th session we have done. Initially, we have done on woman harassment at our place. Then we had IBC. Then we had summary suit and GST, IT, Passport Act, Insurance and MACT Act. Now we have come for the SOHAM, Indian Succession Act. And there are many more, and we'll be repeating also, because everything we are not able to, the speakers not able to complete within an hour. You know very, very well about our subject. So thank you so much for giving your impression. Next, I'll go to Siddharth, partner, Soham Anand's partner. I request Siddharth.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
And good evening to every one of you. Firstly, I would like to congratulate Soham on, you know, completing such a beautiful seminar on the Indian Succession Act, and the chapter in which he had dealt is a humongous chapter, as we all know. He has, you know, crisply and perfectly defined all the terms which are essential for a budding lawyer to know. And these are the things which will come across in his everyday, day-to-day legal matters. So, and I would really appreciate, I'd like to thank Soham again for the manner which he has put forth everything. Few things which were not known to me personally, even being a lawyer, I have come across a few terms in the Succession Act for the first time, which he has graciously and gratefully helped us in knowing them. And I'm really, I would really thank Soham for putting such special effort into it.
Thank you, Siddharth, but we want to see your face.
So basically, we are in the same office right
now. Whatever said and done,
you can show your face to all.
Yeah, you go, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Now yeah, we go.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Really, you said that you have learned from your partner. And
yes,
he is a very good person whom I moved with. And
absolutely, he is a gem of a person.
Yes, last 4 or 5 years I have got linked with him. Now over to Shivaprakash.
Ravi sir, before that, can we have the slides be closed on the display?
Yeah, so I have.
Yeah. Sure, sir, I'll do the stop sharing.
Yes. Now over to Shivaprakash.
Good evening, everybody. Firstly, I want to congratulate for expediting all the various provisions of the Indian Succession Act. Every chapter of it is itself a subject, and he has taken us to all the chapters without leaving anything. And the most lucrative part of it is the Succession section regarding the testamentary and in the non-testamentary. The report is now creating an uproar as far as the Chennai is concerned now. Again, you have explained everything in detail, which should be of use to every young advocate, as said by our brother Ganesh Kumar. Thank you, MPLF, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you,
Shubhra. Hey, you are sitting down and what you are watching.
One second. A person from Bangalore, he is our member, Advocate Ramdas, a senior member, and he wanted to give impression today. He has sent me a message. I request Ramdas Mandi to give his impression.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, everybody. It's a very, very fine, a good session. Hello?
Yeah, here. Hearing.
Yes, sir. Yes, we can hear you. Section. Yeah. Good section. I am very glad to participate in this, your Madras, what is called?
Presidency.
Presidency, lawyers form. I'm very glad. And also, I also give one lecture regarding the some topic in future.
Yes.
Sure, I hope sure. I will do.
Yes.
It sure. Is only by Rick. Beg your pardon?
Hello? It's a blessing for us.
Yes, yes. I will give one day. I'll topic also regarding these things. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now we'll go to question session. Koka. Suresh Kumar, Koka.
Sir, good evening, sir. Thank you for the wonderful session you organized. And I have got a one question. Sir, I have got a client where she has executed two wills.
Okay.
One will unregistered, which is, for example, in 2010.
Okay.
Where it consists of two witnesses.
Okay.
Subsequently, she has executed another will in the year of 2015.
Okay.
Which is registered, but it consists of only one witness.
Okay.
But both the conditions of the registered and unregistered wills are same. There is no any change.
Okay.
So, now how to probate this particular will, sir?
Sir, first of all, the important aspect which we have to consider here is that if two wills have been prepared, the will correct. Which is the subsequent one will have the binding effect. So even if the first will has been registered and it has two witnesses, that will not be having any effect, because the second will which has been prepared, even though it has one witness who has signed, still it has same effect because of the simple fact that it is subsequent in time. So, even though the terms and conditions are same, you will still have to go and at the max, what you will have to do is, as the attesting witness is only one, you will have to take that attesting witness into the court and you will have to prove that will using the said same attesting witness. Apart from that, nothing else can be done.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Next, Mr. Gopi. Not Gopi.
Sir?
Yeah.
Gopi, sir.
Yes.
Sir?
Tell me, what is your question?
Sir, yeah, will is executed in a hospital.
Okay, okay.
Whether it is necessary to doctor has to be examined. Even attested witness, two attested witnesses examined.
Yes.
It is required the doctors has to examine.
Yes. I'll answer you this question in two parts. That first part of this is ki normal course we say or we advise the clients normally to have a doctor's medical certificate to the effect that the person was mentally fit and was mentally fit enough to execute a will. So that if that document is available, it itself proves it. But in your case, if the two witnesses have been examined, it is more than sufficient. Who are the attesting witnesses? You don't require the doctor to be there to prove the will, because the two witnesses are more than sufficient. If there is a medical certificate which has been attached with the will, then it would be great if you could examine the doctor, because that would put an additional benefit to your case, or that would boost your case even more.
For further clarification, if anything, I'll send you the number of correctly. Any other questions, Vignesh?
Sir, I have.
Can I ask one question?
Your name? Your name?
Kanmani.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, Kanmani.
Yes, sir. I can hear you.
Yes, sir. Sir, if both husband and wife are writing a will,
yes,
one of them has demise,
yes,
how it can be executed, sir? The will. In a single will, they have written they have executed a will.
Okay.
One has five.
So, sir, I'll just repeat the question so that to come to know that whether I've got the question rightly. You mean that there is a joint will which has been executed by husband and wife, and in subsequent point of time the husband has expired, and how do you go execution of husband's will, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, sir, it is the same in this case that when the husband has died, whatever will he has made or whatever the legacies which he has created by a way of will, so that can definitely be taken effect to, and the wife's will be would stand as it is. You will have to produce the entire will, but the will, the probate, or as in case of Madras or Bombay, the probate has to be obtained even if there is no executor which is there. So if for the probate, you will have to submit the will of the joint will itself, but the will will take the effect of the husband and not of wife, as wife is still alive.
Okay.
Jayanti, unmute yourself.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, yes, I can hear you. Yes. I can hear you.
My question is, X has expired leaving behind his surviving mother, widow mother,
yes,
and a wife and a daughter.
Okay.
Now, mother has other children also.
Okay.
But the property of X is self-acquitted properties. He's earned by himself. It's not inherited properties.
Okay.
And it's not a single property one state. He is having in several states properties, a few properties in Tamil Nadu, a few properties in Maharashtra, a few properties in Rajasthan, and all those things. Now, if X's mother expires,
yes,
then the other legal heirs of X come into the picture of the property of X.
Other legal heirs
of X's mother.
Okay. Yes.
So in this situation, what would you suggest for succession to the wife and daughter?
More importantly, ma'am, what we'll have to consider here, the aspect of critical aspect here is that when X expired and he had his properties which were situated, so what happens is that the property will be divided into three portions, that is his mother, his wife and his daughter. So after the two portions, that is the two-third portion which is in the name of his wife and his daughter will be safeguarded under any circumstances. But the one-third which goes to his mother, now that becomes the individual property of the mother. So now once she expires, the other her other legal heirs who are present, that will have the right only on the one-third property which that mother owned and not anything otherwise. So that is how it can, that is the legal position of it. But still, maybe if we can like connect on phone or something, and we can then discuss the case in detail, we can see how can how we can safeguard the interest more of the wife and the daughter of X. How we can do that.
Finally.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Just want to add or get your view.
Yes.
This is regarding the will.
Yes.
Written by a person regarding his medical treatment.
Okay.
That's an out trend now going on in the country. How do you view this will?
Sir, I didn't get your question clearly. Could you just repeat it once again, please?
Yeah. A person writes a will.
Yes.
Regarding the medical treatment to be done to him.
Okay. Okay.
In case he becomes not able to visualize or understand what is happening around him.
Okay. Okay.
How do you visualize? How do you see this type of will?
Sir, will can be for any kind of things. It can be a thing which can like many people write. That maybe there are some ceremonies which we have after the death, so they should not be prepared and all. So these are the kind of things which can be definitely mentioned in the will. So as per this also, the will can take an effect in that regard. But more so, again, we have to see that if there are certain clauses which are not in consonance with the Constitution of India, I would like to more particularly take it in this regard. That maybe it is in regards to this thing that if he is not able to walk or something, then or if he is brain dead or something, and what all things will happen. So then we'll have to also see about the aspects of Constitution of India, because ultimately anything cannot be ultra vires to that. So that he can have his own assumptions about how he wishes to be treated, everything. But again, that cannot be something which can be completely predictable to any other set of laws.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
And we are not able to for one final participant, last question. Then Manik and then Meenakshi Sundar.
Thank you, Ravi sir. I'll put the question quick enough. This is about one of my clients. He, at the age of 20-22, was working overseas.
Okay.
So he has purchased a property on his father's name in Chennai.
Okay.
After a few years, when the father was in a deathbed, he has written a will favoring the property on son's name.
Okay.
The client is survived with two siblings, two sisters.
Okay.
Now, after her father passed away, sisters co-jointly agree for a kind of NOC and they write it in a paper and give it off to the brother.
Okay.
Over a period, but this person has not done anything with the will. He has been probated. He has not done anything with the NOC. He has just kept it in the shelves.
Yes.
Enjoying the property for the last 20 years.
Okay.
After 20 years, there is a difference in the family crops up. And sister says, I need a share of that property. Going back from her words.
Okay.
Now, this person has raised the plea saying that I am maintaining the property for the last 20 years. It is me who gave the money for his father to be purchased in his name and all those stuff. But though the case has been won in the lower court, it has gone again for the appeal. and being discussed or being argued for at least 3-4 years now.
Okay.
What is the best way that you advise, sir?
The first thing is this, that first legal aspect or the first legal thing which we need to see here is that even though he has not done anything in regards to the will, there is no limitation which has been prescribed either in Indian Succession Act or in the Limitation Act per se for the application of probate or any other thing in that regard. So any which ways he can say that he has got the property by virtue of will, and also the recitals of the will also form a major issue in this. And if the recitals of will are very clear that the said property was given to was purchased out of the funds which your client of course gave to his father, and eventually it was purchased, so it would be an open and shut case, and the court would have to say that yes, it was purchased by the funds of the your client itself, and by virtue of the will it has been given to your client. So no sister can then say that they want a share in that property.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
And really it was a wonderful thing. And over to Manikandan from under agendas.
Thank you, sir. Before the vote of thanks, may I now request Brother Sir Prakash to have the briefing about the next session after this.
Good evening, everybody. Once again, thank you all for joining us. I hope that this session would have been of great food for your thoughts. Our next session is about the very sensitive topic on human rights by our own member, Dr. Ambigai Das. The sessions probably will be on 5th of June or thereafter, notice of which will be sent to every one of you. I request everyone to join the next sessions also. Over to Manikandan.
Thank you, Brother Prakash. Word of thanks. I, on behalf of Madras Presidency Lawyers Forum, and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the speaker, Soham Anand, for a wonderful session. I thank all the participants for participating in today's session, and I hope all of them will be benefited from this session. Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to place on record our hearty thanks to Ravi Vinaji Sundaram, Brother Swaprakash, Brother Ram Mayappan, and Jayanti Shah for their coordination and making this session a wonderful one.